Exactly positioned as you see here. The tongue is in between those palatal shelves. You see here the very muscular structure is our tongue. And 1 week later at the 7th week, the palatal shelves start to approach each other. They become more horizontal. They start to get closer, and the tongue actually finds a good place inside the mouth. It gets a little bit lower, and with this, the palatal shelves are able to get closer, and they fuse at the end of the 9th week, like this. This is the tongue, palatal shelves, and after the palatal shelves are fused, actually, they are also fused with the nasal septum here. So this is a perfect closure. If this doesn't happen, unfortunately, so we will have a cleft palate. We can see the cleft palate alone as well. But mostly we see cleft palate accompanying with the cleft of the lip, nose and alveolar regions. So the success of cleft lip and palate treatment is a very, very important thing because the most common, like the most common craniofacial anomalies, you need to know the abnormal anatomy of the cleft lip and palate deformity. You should have technical skills. You should improve your skills. What's happening? Okay. And you need to work together with your team. This is very, very important. Team work is important in cleft care, as you see. And as dentists, we have the key position in this group of physicians because starting from the first day of their lives until they are grown up, they are adults, we take care of cleft lip and palate patients all the time as orthodontists. So as I mentioned before, this is a very challenging and long-term care for a dentist. So I'm going to focus on the treatment protocols for every age periods, every growth period. So starting from an infant, of course. In infants, we have two kind of treatment approaches. One of them is feeding plates, which is a passive approach. The other is pre-surgical infant orthopedics. In other words, it's an active approach. If needed, nutrition is universally provided by passive feeding plates. These are like prosthetics, you know, without any denture. They are ought to cover the defect and make easy to the baby to swallow. This is a very, very simple denture. You to take the impression as you do for all of your patients, but of course, taking an impression from a baby is a quite challenging thing. You need to be very careful. And it facilitates feeding. The parents are using the feeding plates only during the feeding stage. They are not using the plate afterwards. And you can create a good space for the tongue to position in a lower level. You provide psychological support for the parents because they feel more confident when they use those plates because they feel like their babies won't get milk into their lungs. They wouldn't aspire the milk. So, if needed, if the baby isn't able to get fed with the feeding bottle, we generally use feeding plates, but not for all patients, only for the ones they are not, who are not able to continue their nutrition without any support. But I'd like to focus on presurgical infant orthopedics a little bit more. You can see two babies here. One is the first one is without any presurgical orthopedics. Nothing was done. Maybe only a feeding plate. You can see the feeding plate here. You can see the acrylic. You know, there's a thread here for security. And this one is with presurgical orthopedics. So if you were a surgeon, which infant would you prefer to operate? I think it's definitely this baby is will be a real challenge, but to operate on this baby would be much, much more easier, you would say. But the thing is, both babies are the same baby, only 3 months apart. This baby was like 16 days old. This baby, I mean, when this picture was taken, the same baby was only 4 months old. I mean, only in 3-4 months, we were able to achieve this result with presurgical infant orthopedics. So the aim of the presurgical infant orthopedics is to reduce the severity of the deformity and to enable the surgeon to achieve better primary repair under less tension of the lip and the muscles, which is very important. Why it's important? Because our babies are like diamonds. They are very precious and they are very fragile. So any cut on a diamond stays forever. And it's the same for a baby. The first surgery is very important for the baby. If your primary surgery is not successful enough, the baby would need to receive more and more surgeries in order to have a good aesthetic result. And unfortunately, this aesthetic result won't be good if there's going to be lots of revisions. So that's the reason why we give importance to presurgical infant orthopedics. But not all patients have that chance to receive it. It's quite a complicated method. And the parents should bring their babies once a week or once in 10 days. But it works very nicely. It needs parent cooperation. The baby's cooperation is very important. But as you can see on the slides, it's not easy to operate on those deformities. Especially you see that this premaxilla and prolabium won't be easy to push back and receive a good aesthetic reason. Result. So this technique was introduced and developed by Dr. Barry Grayson and Kurt Cutting in 1993 in United States. And Dr. Barry Grayson was just recently honored by as the honor of Association Award by American Cleft Lip and Palate Association. It's the big honor, and it's the first time that they gave that award to an orthodontist, which is a very important contribution. So presurgical nasoalveolar molding is making things easy to align and approximate the alveolar segments. It reduces the tension on the lip segments because we are using such kind of tapes to bring the lip segments together. And in the middle of the treatment, we start giving shape to the nose, as you can see here. And by doing this, using nasal stents, we are able to create a columella. Columella is like a colon between the nose, nasal pits like this. And we are able to create a columella just between those nose openings, so which is very important. This is pre-nasoalveolar molding and this is post-nasoalveolar molding. And when we operate on this baby, he won't need any revision surgeries to elongate the columella. This is very important because in order to elongate this columella with conventional surgeries, surgeons need to perform 3 or 4 maybe operations. But when you create this columella from the baby's natural tissue with tissue expansion, the baby won't need any scars on the columella, which is very favorable. This is a unilateral cleft lip and palate baby. This is the 10th day after he was born. The alveolar segments were wide apart, like 1 centimeter apart. And we started molding the alveolar segments first. As you see, they came closer and even they started touching each other. And during this time, at the middle of that alveolar segment alignment, we started giving shape to the nose, as you will see. The nose was depressed at the beginning. The cleft side of the nose, the nostril was depressed, and we started molding the nose structures. And at the end,